A resolution proposed by Mr. Lee. That these colonies are, and of a right ought to be, free and independent states, and that all political connection between them and the country of Great Britain is, and of a right ought to be, totally dissolved.
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire.
Votes yes.
Rhode Island.
Rhode Island votes yes.
Massachusetts.
Massachusetts votes yes.
New York.
New York has yet to receive new instructions from its Constituent Assembly. We therefore respectfully abstain.
Connecticut.
Connecticut votes yes.
New Jersey.
New Jersey votes yes.
Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania votes yes.
Delaware.
Delaware votes yes.
Virginia.
Virginia votes yes.
Maryland.
Maryland votes yes.
North Carolina.
North Carolina votes yes.
South Carolina.
South Carolina votes yes.
Georgia.
Georgia votes yes.
The vote stands. 12 for independence, none against, with one abstention. Resolution carries.
When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to themselves seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. In every stage of these oppressions, we have petitioned for redress in the most humble terms. Our repeated petitions have been answered only by repeated injury. A prince whose character is thus marked by every act which may define a tyrant is unfit to be the ruler of a free people. Nor have we been wanting in attentions to our British brethren. We have warned them from time to time of attempts by their legislature to extend an unwarrantable jurisdiction over us. We have reminded them of the circumstances of our immigration and settlement here. We have appealed to their native justice and magnanimity. We have conjured them by the ties of our common kindred to disavow these usurpations, which would inevitably interrupt our connections and correspondence. They too have been deaf to the voice of justice and of consanguinity. We must therefore acquiesce in the necessity which denounces our separation and hold them as we hold the rest of all mankind, enemies in war, in peace, friends. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America in General Congress, assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by authority of the good people of these colonies solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are, and of a right ought to be, free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states, they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. You may find it odd to hear those words during Christmas season. Dave has just led us in singing familiar Christmas carols. The choir has just reminded us of what a special season this truly is. And so it is not my desire in any way to diminish our celebration of the greatest feat in all of human history. Someone once said that man's feet on the moon is the greatest accomplishment in human history. Actually, it is not. God's feet on planet Earth is the greatest accomplishment in human history. And we celebrate this in December. And so I in some ways regret that circumstances have compelled me, at least as best as I know my heart and what God would have me to communicate to you, to have to talk to you about this subject in light of this wonderful season. But Jesus came to set us free. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Now we know the greatest freedom is that of the soul, that of the mind. But we also realize that freedom
from physical restraint and control is paramount to our expressing our faith and living our lives in a way that we believe would honor God. And therefore, I cannot think of a better time to focus on what I'm going to be sharing with you today. On November the 17th, 1863, then President Abraham Lincoln was asked to deliver a few appropriate remarks at the dedication of a national cemetery in a place called Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Lincoln has his moments, both good and bad. Some of you may be huge fans of Abraham Lincoln. Others of you may not think that highly of him. This is one of the only photographs that exists of Lincoln on the speaker's podium. You can see him right there off to the left of center. An enlargement of that photograph reveals this. He delivers what many consider to be the greatest speech ever delivered by an American president. And yet it was probably one of the shortest. And he ends with these words that have become all too familiar to most of us. He said that those that had died there, he prayed, had not died in vain, but that government of the people, government by the people, and government for the people shall not perish from the earth. I fear that we're living in a time where Lincoln's greatest fear could be realized. We have an incredible heritage. We have an incredible blessing that we have received from God, that we are a chosen people who have been allowed to live in relative freedom and liberty. What we have, most of us do not treasure very highly because we take it for granted. We do not realize that most people, not only alive on planet Earth today, but who have ever lived, have not enjoyed the freedoms we have. I think for most of us, we have forgotten the price that was paid. Just a moment ago, we played for you the clip from the series John Adams, where in Independence Hall, the delegates voted to declare their independence from Great Britain. And you could even see in the actors the heaviness that was upon them. We celebrate this day every 4th of July. But you understand, at that moment, these men were terrified. The weight that fell upon them was massive. Very possibly one of the heaviest moments that men were ever called upon to endure. Thank God they did. But you could see in their faces the difficulty with which they were executing their responsibility. I began last week talking to you about the subject of irreconcilable. Today I want to talk to you about the subject of irrevocable. It brings me no pleasure to tell you that I believe that America is irreconcilably divided today. The election of just a few weeks ago and the ensuing events only serve to emphasize that fact. But it didn't begin 3 weeks ago. We talked last week that for something to be irreconcilable, it must be an idea, a fact, or a statement representing findings or points of view that are so different from each other that they cannot be made compatible. We saw that the Bible does not teach that Christians are to seek peace at any cost. In fact, Paul says to the Roman Christians, if it is possible, live at peace with all men. But he clearly implies it is not always possible. Jesus, the great Prince of Peace, who did come to bring peace between sinners and God, said that he did not come to bring peace necessarily between individuals. Oh, that would be God's desire, but in a fallen world, it is practically impossible. He said, no, the truth is that the message that I preach will make enemies for you, even out of your own family. When we cannot reconcile with someone, Jesus tells us, for instance, in Matthew 10, verses 13 and 14, that we are to shake off the dust of our feet. In Romans chapter 16, verses 17 and 18, Paul says, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. The great overarching principle is restated in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, where the Lord says, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch the unclean thing. There are times when things are irreconcilable. I went through a list of things last week showing you just how divergent and polarized we are. They don't want free speech, we do. They don't want religious expression, we do. They don't want our history, we do. They don't want individual liberty, we do. And the list could go on and on and on. But to show you just how opposite we are from one another, I want to play for you a little short clip. This is Chris Cuomo, who just a few years ago was talking with Judge Roy Moore. The subject is, where do our rights come from? You can only imagine that Cuomo does not believe that our rights come from God. Judge Roy Moore, of course, takes a different position. It's not a very long clip, so watch and listen in amazement at Chris Cuomo.
Personal opinion, right? But times change, definitions change. We didn't think blacks were equal to whites.
I believe that's a matter of law, because our rights contained in the Bill of Rights do not come from the Constitution. They come from God. It's clearly stated.
Our rights do not come from God, Your Honor, and you know that. They come from man.
Well, let me ask you one question. Let me ask you one question, Chris. Is the Declaration of Independence law?
You would call it organic law as a basis for future laws off of it.
I would call it the organic law because the United States Code calls it organic law. It is organic law because the law of this country calls it the organic law of our country, means where our rights come from. And if they come from there, men can't take
our
them away.
Our rights do not come from God. That's your faith. That's my faith, but that's not our country.
Well,
our laws
now
come
that's
from
not
the
a matter of faith,
collective
sir.
Agreement and compromise.
It's not a matter of faith, sir. It's a matter of organic law, which states we hold these truths to be self-evident.
That's how divided we are. Our Declaration of Independence, our national birth certificate, says that we receive our unalienable rights from God. Amen. Maybe Chris Cuomo needs to read that declaration again. Amen. Although it wouldn't do him any good because he rejects it. You heard him there in that very short period of time. He rejects the whole concept that rights come from God to man. He believes that rights come from government to man. This is how irreconcilable we are. Because you realize, depending on what side of that debate you stand on, everything changes. If our rights come from God, man cannot do anything to alter them, and they are truly unalienable. But if our rights come from other men, i.e., governments of men, well, then what the government grants in one generation, Cuomo was arguing, times change, definitions change. What one government grants and bequeaths to people in one era, it may take away in the next. So freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom of religion, freedom to defend yourself by gun ownership. Well, those are all relative to the era in which you live, according to people like Chris Cuomo. Or they are eternal truths that our framers were smart enough to understand and articulate in our national birth certificate. So the real question is, which side of the issue will we be on? They don't want the Declaration. We do. They believe rights come from government. We don't. How do you reconcile this? Well, the point is, you do not. So then what do? Well, this is where the word irrevocable enters our discussion. What is something if it's irrevocable? Well, it is not able to be changed, reversed, or recovered. It is final. Now, not everything in life is irrevocable. As much as we don't like to admit it, though God intends for marriage to be one man, one woman for life, because of the sinfulness of man, God allows marriages to be dissolved under very limited circumstances. Infidelity, the primary one. Now, of course, it'd always be God's will that the couple reconciles and fixes their relationship, but a marriage can be revoked. I've also added that I have counseled women who are in physical danger to take those children and get out of that house. So marriage at some points is not irrevocable. Partnerships, though we create contracts and we sign agreements, are not irrevocable. We all know of partners and businesses that kind of ran a wheel off and started to abuse the other partner or partners, and ultimately attorneys had to be secured and contracts, agreements had to be legally broken and dissolved. Not all partnerships are irrevocable. Even a pastor's relationship to his congregation is not irrevocable. Paul talks about how elders who sin should be rebuked publicly. And the New Testament talks about how a pastor can disqualify himself and have to be removed. So not everything in life is irrevocable. Oh, some things are. Thank the Lord for that. Things like salvation. If you're in Christ, Paul says nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That is an irrevocable relationship. If you do not have that relationship today, at the end of this service, you will be given the opportunity to meet the Lord and enter into that irrevocable relationship for all eternity. Our rights, I believe, are irrevocable. This is why they are called unalienable. We cannot be alienated from our rights, thus unalienable, irrevocable rights. Rights like the right to freely associate with who we choose and to not associate with who we choose not to associate with. See, that's an irrevocable right. No one, including government, has the right to force you into associations that violate your faith. And yet right now, sitting in the House of Representatives is something called the Equality Act that has already been passed by the House, awaiting the moment when the leftists take over the Senate and they will march that bill over to the Senate and they will pass that. And at that moment, your religious beliefs, your faith, can be violated by legislative fiat. Now, even though they claim that they can do that, in the end, they cannot. And this is the very moment in which we live that causes us to have to talk about these things. Political agreements, compacts, even constitutions are revocable. We don't like to think about this. But with last week's introduction to this message, there are times when we're just irreconcilably divided. And there's nothing we can do other than to separate. Separate. To revoke the original agreement, the original compact, the original contract, the original constitution. We celebrate people in history who've done this. Just a few days ago, we celebrated the separatists. Now, this church knows, but most people think that the Pilgrims were Puritans. They were anything but Puritan. They were separatists. And they disobeyed the King of England to separate themselves from the English church at great risk. Dr. Paul Jaley reminded us just a few days ago of some of the risk that was taken for that little band of separatists to break away, initially going to Holland and then finally crossing the Atlantic Ocean, the worst possible time of the year, 66 days tossed back and forth in that little ship that we know as the Mayflower, only to be blown off course and land in an area that they had not planned on. It was so desolate when they first landed there that William Bradford's wife, we believe, committed suicide by jumping off the side of the ship and drowning. And yet we celebrate these people because they were willing to sever a long-standing tie because differences had become irreconcilable. So this is where we are today. And although it is not my desire on Sunday mornings to turn messages into history lessons, where else can we deal with this subject? To quote from Abraham Lincoln again, early in his political career, he was told that he could not talk about the abolition of slavery in political circles because that was bringing religion into politics. He said, but then on the other hand, I'm told that I cannot talk about abolition of slavery in religious circles because that's bringing politics into religion. And so he asked, where, pray tell, can we talk about this subject? Paul and I believe that we have a spiritual responsibility to take the Word of God and shine it on our lives from day to day. Amen. And to use God's Word to help us to interpret not only what's going on around us, but what we must do. This is what the separatists that we call the Pilgrims did. This is what the framers a little over a century later did. Were they all born again Christians? Probably not. Let's not over Christianize them. But that era was an era of profound respect for the Bible and the principles enshrined therein. And even those who did not claim a personal relationship to Christ had a pretty strong respect for the Bible and the God of the Bible and the principles of liberty they found in the scriptures. They looked elsewhere, of course. It was not just their belief in Scripture, but there are some things that we need to remember that they believed. Now, you may argue, well, they just said what they said when they said it because it was convenient for that time. Well, that may be so, but I cannot know the motives of individuals. All I can do is look at what people do, what they say, and what they write, and judge them accordingly. It's what Jesus called judging a tree by its fruit. I cannot know the heart of anyone in my era, and I certainly can know the heart of anyone living in the 1770s. But listen to what James Madison, who was the primary author of the U.S. Constitution, wrote in Federalist 39, "The proposed government," and he's talking there about the federal government, "cannot be deemed a national one." Think of how foreign that is to this modern audience. That's all we hear, the national government. "Since its jurisdiction extends to certain enumerated objects only and leaves to the several states a residuary and inviolable sovereignty over all other objects." In other words, what the author of the U.S. Constitution is saying is that the federal government is not a national government controlling everything in all, at that time, 13 states, but only had authority where it had been given specific authority. Is that the way it works today? In Federalist 14, Madison says, "The general," he's speaking there of the federal government, "is not to be charged with the whole power of making and administering laws. Its jurisdiction is limited to certain enumerated objects." What are called the enumerated powers? Article 1, Section 8 of the U.S. Constitution. Depending on how you count them, there are some 18. That's it. Now I want you to think with me for just a moment. Do you think that the framing generation of the 1770s would have fought an 8-year war against the most powerful military in the world, against the largest empire that existed at that time? Do you think they would have fought that 8-year war, sacrificed in goods, personal belongings, blood, sweat, tears, many of them with their lives, just so they could win and design the same kind of government they had just fought for 8 years to get out from under? Does that make any kind of sense at all? No. Now, to illustrate this to you, by the time John Adams is president, the Alien and Sedition Acts had been passed. Without going into heavy detail, basically what the Alien and Sedition Act said is you cannot criticize the federal government. If you criticize the federal government, you can be arrested, you can be fined, you can be thrown in jail. They actually executed those powers and did just that, even imprisoning a congressman. Well, James Madison, the author of the U.S. Constitution, and Thomas Jefferson, the author of the Declaration of Independence, led out in a response to what they believed was a very unconstitutional situation that, if was not addressed, all of our liberties could be violated, and ultimately the federal government could do just about whatever it wanted to, because if you can't criticize it, then doesn't it have sole authority? Where's freedom of speech? Where's freedom of assembly? Where's the freedom to petition your government to redress grievances? Well, it's non-existent if you can't criticize the federal government and can be thrown in jail if you do. Rightly then, the two authors of our founding documents were very concerned. Listen to what Madison writes in his Virginia Resolution, 1798, that this assembly, the Virginia Assembly, most solemnly declares a warm attachment to the union of the states. It is their duty to watch over and oppose every infraction of those principles which constitute the only basis of that union. That's very important that you understand what he's saying here. He says that the only basis that holds the union together is the ability of the states to hold the federal government in check. He says, without that power, the union breaks apart. Because a faithful observance of them can alone secure its existence. What is its existence? The union. And the public happiness. He says, in case of a deliberate palatable and dangerous exercise of other powers. What do you mean other powers? Well, powers that the federal government just bequeaths to itself, not listed in the U.S. Constitution. Not granted by the said compact, that's the Constitution. The states who are parties thereto have the right and are in duty bound to interpose for arresting the progress of the evil. Thomas Jefferson, in the Kentucky Resolution, written that very same year, said that whensoever the general government assumes undelegated powers, its acts are unauthoritative, void, and of no force. Consider Obamacare. According to the author of the Declaration of Independence, our national birth certificate, Obamacare is unauthoritative and void. In a letter to George Washington on February the 15th, 1791, Jefferson said this: to take a single step beyond the boundaries thus specifically drawn around the powers of Congress, that would be by the Constitution, is to take possession of a boundless field of power no longer susceptible of any definition. This is one of the reasons why Paul and I have been so outspoken against things like mask mandates. It's not that we don't want you to wear a mask, and you have freedom of choice to decide whether or not you feel safer by wearing a mask. We have tried to lay before you some of the science that refutes what government agents have been telling us. But indeed, it's not the mask in and of itself. It's the authority that governors and mayors have bequeathed upon themselves to force you to wear a mask. Because by the same power, they could force you to wear a football helmet, or to wear a pair of rubber flippers, or to put on a suit of armor, or to wear a hazmat suit, or to stay in your house, shut your business, and close down your church. That's why this is so important. If we believe that the preaching of the gospel is the most important thing we can do in life, then surely we would believe that the second most important thing is to defend the right to do the most important thing. So I stand before you to defend the right of conscience and of speech. And yet, my friends, we are right on the verge of having those stripped from us. That's why this is so important. It's not just a bunch of political gobbledygook. This is life and death. History shows that tyrants always use the same steps to enslave their subjects. There's nothing new about this. There was nothing new about this in 1776. They had seen all of this before. And there's nothing new about it today. People are no more evil today than they were in the 1400s. Man is fallen. Man has this insatiable desire, because of his fallenness, to control his fellow citizens. And without great restraint, some can rise to a position of power to do just that. I'm 61. I've lived most of my life. I still have effective years left, but I have no idea how long I will be on this planet. But I have children who are in their early 30s. Who have children, my grandchildren, who are anywhere from still in the womb and about to be born in a few months to the age of 7. It is for their future that I am speaking out, not my own. Do I want to end my life in a prison? No. But I am willing to pledge my life and my fortune and my sacred honor to keep them free. And I am willing Alexander Hamilton, who is not one of my favorite framers, because he was a big government guy, and I think he would be appalled to see what big government looks like in 2020. But he says, if the federal government should overpass the just bounds of its authority and make a tyrannical use of its powers, by the way, it has, the people whose creature it is, notice the government is a creation of the people. Now, this harkens back to what Lincoln said in Gettysburg in 1863, government of, by, and for the people must appeal to the standard they have formed and take such measures to redress the injury done to the Constitution as the exigency, that means the circumstances, the urgent need, may suggest and prudence justify. I'm here to tell you that's where we are today. Great injury has already been done to our liberties. And with the most probable inauguration of President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris, even greater damage, maybe irreparable damage, to our liberties is about to occur. So what do we do? Well, first we all have to establish, have we reached an irreconcilable spot? I personally believe we have. There are certain things that are revocable, but unalienable rights are not among them. Constitutions are revocable. Compacts are revocable. But eternal truths are irrevocable. And it's upon those that we stand, and we can do no other. So here's the thing. Chris Cuomo says our rights don't come from God, they come from government, meaning then that the government can take them away. Well, how many liberties are you willing to give up? How many of us are willing to go down with the ship? Because there is at least half of this country that wants to remake the American Republic into something else, and I promise you, that something else you're not going to like. And so do we just stand by and say, well, we're locked in, there's nothing we can do about it? Did the 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th Amendments lock us in so that we can't do anything about it? Do you honestly believe that the framers who wrote the original documents would have stood by and done nothing? And yet we practically have. So I'm doing what I realize is greatly misunderstood in our time and not popular with many, but I am calling for a political separation. Amen. I'm calling for a political divorce. Just like the divorce or political separation that Thomas Jefferson called for in the Declaration of Independence. He tells us in that document what we are to do. He says governments are created to secure our rights, those unalienable rights. That these governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed. Do you consent to what the federal government is doing today? No. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, what ends? Our unalienable rights, including life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, which involves the ability to acquire property. And yet AOC and her squad are claiming that government has the right to take what you've earned and to redistribute it to those who won't work. By the way, the separatists that we call the Pilgrims experimented with that. Remember how that worked out for them? They nearly starved to death. until William Bradford said, no, we're going to be capitalists. I'm going to give you a piece of land. It's yours. You farm it, you eat. You don't farm it, you don't eat. Paul said the same thing in the New Testament. If you don't work, you don't eat. So when any form of government, including our own, becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people. Notice, the right of the people. Not the rebellion of the people, the right of the people. To do what? To alter, to abolish it, and later on, as I read earlier, to throw it off. Now, by the way, those are three DEFCON levels. To alter is DEFCON 3. That means that our government's gotten off course and we just have to do some course corrections. To abolish it is DEFCON 2. That means the government has gotten so far off track that it cannot be fixed and we have to redo it. So we abolish what we have and we create a new. DEFCON 1 is when we've blown through those two warnings and we've waited so long that now our government has become a tyranny and we have to throw it off. Which is what they were doing. Depicted in that clip we saw a while ago from the series John Adams. Where are we today? I believe we're at DEFCON 2. But we're quickly racing to DEFCON 1. And if we do not figure out a way to peacefully, I'm calling for peaceful separation. If we do not find a way to peacefully separate and simply say to those who don't want our history, who don't want freedom of speech, who don't want freedom of religion, who do not want the right to own private property or to be able to own a firearm for self-defense, to allow them to go do that peacefully with our blessings. But to allow us who do believe in those things to pursue those with their blessings. If we do not, and you mark my words, if we do not figure out a way to peacefully separate, we will either be overrun by tyranny and many of us will finish our days on this earth in jail, or we will be shooting at each other. This is why this is so important. No one wants to shoot at anybody. I don't want a war. Do you want a war? But I'll tell you what I also don't want. I don't want a federal government that can tell me when I can preach and when I can't, and when we can open our church and when we can't, and to use emergency powers to enact all of these unconstitutional measures to tell me that I have to embrace what the Bible calls sinful perversion, that I have to perform same-sex weddings, or I'm violating their civil rights. I will not do this. Never. Not because I have any hatred toward those people. I believe what they do is wrong. But I will not condone what they do. Nor can you. And be true to God's word. So, what does Jefferson then say we must do? He said we must institute new government. You understand, these are not my words, none of them. These are the words in our national birth certificate. He said we must institute new government. It's time for that. Laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them, meaning those who have been aggrieved, shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. So following Thomas Jefferson's own advice, this is what we are to do. Now, we're a small congregation. On a good Sunday, we have some 400 people here. I'm not a powerful individual. My message does not go very far. Of course, we have an internet presence, social media, where our message goes a little further than just to those who attend. But we're not a large church. But all I can do is tell you what I believe to be true, and then to be true to you, to be as transparent as I can possibly be to you. This is all I can do. But I would imagine that those men that were sitting in Independence Hall in July of 1776 felt rather small themselves. Sometimes large things have small beginnings. Now, as I begin to close this message, I want you to know that that generation did not relish what was about to happen. Jonas Clark, who was the pastor of the church in Lexington, Massachusetts, 1 year after the Battle of Lexington, preached a sermon about it. Listen to what he said. The connection of America with Britain might have been preserved inviolate to the end of time, and it may be added that there is no just ground to suppose that it would have ever entered the heart of Americans to have desired a dissolution of so happy a connection with the mother country, or to have sought independence of Britain had they not been urged and even forced upon such an expedient by measures of oppression and violence and the shedding of innocent blood. Abraham Catullus, a preacher who preached all over the Northeast, in a 1777 election sermon said, "All our assemblies have endeavored by the most humble and earnest petitions to the throne to prevent the fatal war, which now rages and desolates our land. And it was not until every pacific measure failed and our petitions were scornfully treated and rejected and a powerful fleet and army had actually invaded us and shed our blood that we took up arms in behalf of our lives and liberties." A preacher and soldier in the Continental Army, William Gordon, preached a sermon on July the 4th, 1777, the first year anniversary of the signing of the Declaration. I actually have a copy of his sermon. Said, "This continent complained of real grievances and humbly petitioned. Instead of being heard and relieved, the yoke was increased by fresh acts of cruelty and new burdens laid upon the continent. Our first grievances were spoken of as if not real, and as though we complained without cause. We were at once plunged into a defensive war. Still, we were desirous, if possible, of an accommodation. We therefore petitioned again without rising in our requests, only enlarging them to take in new grievances. Instead of having them redressed, we were deemed and were to be treated as rebels." I could give you quote after quote. For sake of time, I'm going to pass through some of these quotes. And I want to get to the final quote that I have from a man by the name of John Witherspoon. As you can see, he was a member of the Continental Congress that voted to separate from Great Britain, signed the Declaration of Independence. He was also the president of what later became Princeton University. He was a Presbyterian preacher. Dr. John Krebs was a witness of the scene that I'm about to read to you. He said, "Every eye went to him," meaning to Witherspoon, "with the quickness of thought and remained with the fixedness of the polar star. He cast on the assembly a look of inexpressible interest and unconquerable determination, while on his visage the hue of age." At that time, Witherspoon was 64. "Was lost in the flush of burning patriotism that fired his cheek." Now, what caused everyone to pay such close attention to John Witherspoon? He stood and he gave this speech. "There is a tide in the affairs of men," he said, "a nick of time. That noble instrument on your table, meaning the Declaration of Independence, which ensures immortality to its author, that would be Thomas Jefferson, should be subscribed this morning by every person of this house. He that will not respond to its accents and strain every nerve to carry into effect its provisions is unworthy the name of free man. For my own part of property, I have some, of reputation more. That reputation is staked, that property is pledged on the issue of this contest. And although these gray hairs must descend into the sepulcher, I would infinitely rather they should descend thither by the hand of the executioner than desert at this crisis the sacred cause of my country. The delegation heard that speech, heeded Witherspoon's advice, and voted to separate from Great Britain. And the rest is history. This is where we are today. It is time for political separation, peaceful separation. Our differences are irreconcilable. And our rights, well, Chris Cuomo is wrong. Our rights are from God, and they're irrevocable. Amen. And we must demand, the people must demand that our unalienable rights be protected at all costs. Amen. Now, I want to close with one last clip. It's from a movie that many of you are familiar with. It's the movie called The Patriot. Mel Gibson plays a composite figure who goes by the name of Benjamin Martin in the movie. There is no one character, although some believe that he's slightly playing the part of a gentleman called the Swamp Fox. But he's kind of a composite individual. He had fought in the French and Indian War and hated war. He was called by his own convention in Virginia to vote to separate, but he did not want to fight. Now, because he keeps his family out of the fray except for his oldest son, if you've seen the movie, you know that he loses one of his sons, and then with two of his younger sons ambushes the British squad of soldiers that has captured his oldest son, played by Heath Ledger, and finally frees him and eventually enters the war and becomes a pivotal part of winning our independence. I want you to watch this clip. Watch his defiance early on, and then I want you to listen to what he says at the very end, because at the very end you're going to hear him comment after he had decided to fight.
Would you tell me, please, Mr. Howard, why should I trade one tyrant 3,000 miles away for 3,000 tyrants 1 mile away? An elected legislature can trample a man's rights as easily as a king can.
Captain Martin, I understood you to be patriot.
If you mean by patriot, am I angry about taxation without representation? Well, yes, I am. Should the American colonies govern themselves independently? I believe they can, and they should. But if you're asking me, am I willing to go to war with England? Well, then the answer is most definitely no. There are alternatives to war. We take our case before the king. We plead with him.
Yes, we've tried that.
Well, then we try again and again, if necessary, to avoid a war.
Benjamin, I was at Bunker Hill. The British advanced three times, and we killed over 700 of them at point-blank range, and still they took the ground. That is the measure of their resolve. Now, if your principles dictate independence, then war is the only way. It has come to that.
I have 7 children. My wife is dead. Now, who's to care for them if I go to war? I will not fight. And because I will not fight, I will not cast a vote that will send others to fight in my stead.
And your principles?
I'm a parent. I haven't got the luxury of principles.
You've done nothing for which you should be ashamed.
I've done nothing. And for that, I am ashamed.
I have done nothing. And for that, I am ashamed. It is time for every liberty-loving Oklahoman to stand and say no further. No further. Would you bow with me in prayer? Before I pray, let me say to you that if you do not have peace with God, Jesus came to give you that peace. He is the Prince of Peace, and he will set you free from your sins. If you want to come today and meet the one who died for you, come. We have counselors who will be here to pray with you. Maybe you're a Christian and you know that you have not been faithful to what God has called you to do. Then come today. Never a better time than December to recommit your life to what God has called you to do and to be. Maybe like the character in The Patriot, you've kind of ridden other people's coattails and you've done nothing. And for that, you are ashamed. Well, now is the time to begin to learn these principles and to stand for what we know is right. Maybe you ought to join this church. You know that pastors all over this state should be preaching on these topics. You know it. Then you should join this church and link arms with us and help us.